which means as other educators, I believe we have yet to calibrate around what it means to give children access to instruction of the highest quality. And so that's what my conversation is about with you today. I haven't got to the picture yet. I'm just building the frame. So here's the picture. So y'all, that's me. I'm still handsome. But I was one of those kids who grew up in abject poverty. Do any of you serve children in abject poverty? Yeah. Raise your hand if you do. Thank you. Yeah. My mother was a drug addict, and my father, I don't know. But I'm standing on stage with you today after having written 35 books and getting a PhD from George Washington University. Yeah. And so, some of you didn't clap. You're such a hater. You're such a hater. But I didn't say that to brag. I said that to say, you don't know who you're serving. So, because I was tired of moving too much with my mother, changing schools too much, I said, can I go live with my grandmother at 12? And she said, if you get her to say yes, you can go. So I got her to say yes. I put on my uniqueness, my charm, and my talent. And she said yes. But I knew the conditions that I was going to weren't going to get any better. But I knew it was better for me academically, so I begged her. She said yes, and for 7 years, I slept on the floor of my grandmother's living room, and through the floor, I could see the ground. And on a regular basis, I slept on that floor with just a sheet. All I had was a sheet, and I was bit by rodents on a regular basis. And what am I trying to say? My grandmother didn't have a whole lot of money, but what she had was hope for me. What she had was love for me. And I'm trying to say the same thing to you. As the children you're serving, some of them, they don't have a lot of money, but they require on you to stand in the gap for them, because in some cases, you're all they have. And I was one of those children from whom no one came. I remember getting inducted into the National Junior Honor Society as an 11th grader, and nobody from my family came. And I remember my classmates having those, what do you call them, camcorders. Their parents had the camcorders on their shoulders back in the late 80s and the 90s. They weren't in your phone, they were on your shoulder. And I remember all my classmates having those moments captured, and I was there by myself, and on the inside I was weeping. But I said to myself, down there, you're going to go, you're going to have the experience, and you're going to get better because of it. Who cares that they're not here? I coached myself, but I was embarrassed. And then I remember graduating from high school at the top of my class. I received 16 merit-based scholarships to attend the University of Texas at Austin. And after having graduated from high school, nobody from my family came. And I was a keynote speaker for the graduation, and none of them were there. And I remember graduating 5 years later to be a little while from the University of Texas at Austin, and no one came. And I remember getting a graduate degree, and no one came. And I remember thinking, maybe I can earn a terminal degree, and guess what? Nobody came. There were children underneath your care for whom no one will come, but they have potential. And their story may not be mine, and your story may not be mine, but if you don't serve them, no one will. And I have to believe this, that what we do unto the least of them, we do also unto him. Okay, I know I'm in New York, but you know what I'm talking about. I know I'm not in the Bible Belt, but what we do to the least of them, and what I mean by the least of them, children who can't do anything in return for us, how we serve them is going to determine how we get access later. Believe that. And what a man soweth, that will he reap. Okay, I got a Baptist in the front. Y'all are Episcopalian in the back, no problem. I like that. That's how you enter a room when a keynote speaker is on the stage. Because everybody up front, they want to hear what I have to say, I think. Okay, let's keep going. Our responsibility as public educators is to make sure that the public education that we produce for children, is worthy of consumption. Because some of what our children are consuming, and I'm not indicting you, we're all teachers. Some of what kids are consuming every day is not worthy of consumption. And you know for a fact that you would not want your own biological children as a student in some of your colleagues' classrooms. Somebody said, talk about it. I'm trying. And it's not because your colleagues are bad people. It's because sometimes they don't have access to ongoing, high-quality professional learning opportunities, and they don't have access to the resources they need to do the best they can. The best they can is not enough. So then what is enough? Brooklyn, your RTI pyramid doesn't look like this one. Okay, y'all don't call it that anymore, you call it MTSS. I don't care what you call it, it's the same thing. What am I trying to say? In a regular situation, let me not call it regular, in a situation where the majority of your students have already reached proficiency, 80% of them are at the bottom of this pyramid in green, which means what? You can use a program of study right off the shelf and help that population because nobody's struggling. In a regular RTI pyramid situation, 10% of your population to 12% of your population, they're in the yellow, which means what? Depending upon what you're teaching, they may need a little help. But the green says they got it coming through the door, and anything you introduce them to, they can handle it. The yellow means that depending upon the day, they might struggle and they might need a little bit of support. Now, what does the red mean in a regular situation? The red means that they're in trouble and they look like they've never been to school a day in their lives academically. You ask them to solve a two-step algebraic equation and they can't multiply and divide. You ask them to determine central idea and they have no idea what the prerequisite is. I can find key details. You ask them to read a text. They read the text out loud, you ask them a question, they can't answer any of those questions. That's the red. But your pyramid doesn't look like that. When your pyramid looks like that, here's what you can do. You have enough staff members to pull out the kids who need support, because only the yellow sometimes, and the red needs support. But your pyramid doesn't look like this. Your pyramid looks like that. So I saw the data that Executive Superintendent Ross put up on the screen. It said to me that about 60, sometimes 70, sometimes 80% of your population has yet to reach proficiency in the 12 content areas. Your RTI pyramid is inverted. Which means you can't take the right side of pyramid approach to teaching and learning. You've got to take an inverted pyramid approach to teaching and learning. I'm going somewhere, stay with me. So when your RTI pyramid is upside down, who you have at the bottom of the pyramid is different. Who's at the bottom of this pyramid? You're highly able and gifted kids, and they're bored as hell. Because everybody's focusing on the bubble kids. Now who's in the yellow? Your kids who came through the door proficient but could slide either way if they get ignored too long, because everybody's focusing on the bubble kids. And these are the yellow and the red in this pyramid. The majority of your population, Brooklyn North, they're in the red. Raise your hand in this room if you're sick and tired of being sick and tired. I came to help you. So if your RTI pyramid is upside down like this, you can't take a pull-out approach to improving student outcomes. Because sometimes when kids get pulled out of your classroom, they're not getting access to anything better than what they were getting in your room. Uh-oh, they got quiet. You have to be able to trust what they're getting when they're being pulled out. But you can't take a pull-out approach because you have too many kids who need support. You've got to take a push-in approach. What do I mean by push-in approach? Everything I'm going to show you in just a few minutes before I run out of time, you've got to push it into your core content area courses, irrespective of your discipline, irrespective of your grade level. Here it is. No matter where I go, there goes significant gains in student outcomes, no matter who I'm helping. So I'm helping 38 school districts in 38 states and in 7 countries, and no matter where I go, when folks put into place what I'm getting ready to share with you now, children do better right away. So here it is. Here's where you push in. Your kids who can only call out words, they need support in this area. I know your high school, tier one words, they didn't get them. What's a tier one word? A word like there, T-H-E-R-E, versus a word like there, T-H-E-I-R. T-H-E-I-R refers to what? Possession. T-H-E-R-E refers to what? Position. But there are children under your care who don't know the 100 or so tier one words that they're supposed to know for their grade level. And they didn't get the ones in the grade level below. And they didn't get access to the ones in the grade level below that one. And they didn't get access to the multiple grade levels below those. But we're expecting them to analyze even similar documents of historical and literary significance with a focus on themes, purposes, and rhetorical features, which is one of your state standards. And they don't know the difference between there and there. Good luck. So my question to you as a district, as Brooklyn North, what is your focus on tier one words? Is there one? Because I think wherever kids go, they should see those tiered words. So I'm not saying spend time teaching kids tier one words. I'm saying make sure they're aware of them and you have a way of knowing if they don't know them. So when they sit on the toilet in the restroom, when they leave the classroom and they look up, they should see them in the ceiling. That's how important they are. Okay, let me move. Tier two words. I'm trying to show you what it's going to take for children to become literate. What are tier two words, Brooklyn North? They're words that cross grade levels and content areas, and there's only 36 of them in the entirety of the English language, and they're the words that live on the assessment that keep them from being able to demonstrate proficiency. You taught them, but then when they get to the test stands in the way. So what's on the test? Tier two words are inside of every single test question, no matter the grade level, no matter the discipline. And I'm not about the test, because I think if kids have access to high quality instruction, the test will take care of itself. And so what are tier two words? They're words like analyze. But if I gave everybody in this room a post-it note and asked you to give me the definition for analyze, guess what? As many people as there are in this room, I would get that many definitions of the word analyze. So imagine a child going from, in Brooklyn North, from third grade all the way up to 12th grade, and every time they get asked to analyze something, they get a different definition for analyze. They become instructionally schizophrenic. What I mean is instructionally schizophrenic, they hear voices. Whose voices do they hear? Teachers who care about them, who didn't calibrate around what it means to analyze. Tier three words stand in their way. What's a tier three word? A tier three word is a word that lives inside of your discipline, like in social studies, sovereignty. Like ELA, onomatopoeia. Like mathematics, isosceles. They're words that live inside of your discipline, that when kids encounter those words, we've got to make sure that before we go too far in our instruction, they understand exactly what those words mean. But kids, you know what we do, especially when we're being observed. We say to kids, okay, everybody, let's look at the objective. Let's read the objective, and let's see if we accomplish the objective, okay? Everybody, somebody read the objective, and they read the objective out loud. And then we say to kids, if we accomplish it, and because we're being observed, they know. They say, yes. And then a lie and a truth ain't in them. Because if they don't have conceptual understanding of every word that lives in that objective, they have not reached proficiency. And what do I mean? Let's say you're teaching mathematics. You want students to be able to complete a function table. And you want them to be able to graph the relationship and describe the relationship between the independent and dependent variable. There's some tier three words and some tier two words in that objective that children must know conceptually before we do too much teaching. And what are those words? Function, function table, graph, describe, independent, dependent variable. And so without instruction on the front end on what all of those words mean that live inside of your learning target, they just play in school. Now, look on the side here. I'm going to put something in on the flanks. So tier one words, which are solid words, and your kids didn't get them early on, so they're struggling in your content area, and we're waiting on the cavalry, but we are the cavalry. They're tier two words that cross grade levels and disciplines like describe, analyze, tone, inference, may not be there, summarize it. And then there are tier three words that live only in your discipline. But they can't even get to those tier words if they can't decode, which is what? Look at a word and know what sounds to make. There are children sitting in your high school classrooms. They look at a word and they read and they say, oh, I don't know that word. And what they're actually saying is, I don't know how to decode that word. And we say, oh, they're so low, these kids, they're low, they're so low. Well, how do they get high? Well, I know how they can get high, but as it comes to reading, how do they get higher? We've got to say, oh, you're going to read out loud in my classroom. I'm not going to lecture you to death because that keeps you reading below grade level. I'm going to have you find information on my content through reading opportunities. So when you read out loud, I can see where your issues are with decoding. So I can help you to have a choice-filled life rather than a life that's characterized by other people making choices for you. Because people are waiting on your kids to fail so they can give them low-paying jobs and take advantage of them. And so I was reading with an 11th grader and Little Rock, and the little guy, he was a star of the basketball team. They're using him on the basketball court, but nobody taught him how to read. There's a special place in hell for people who use children. If it's going to help other children, I agree with you, but I'm going to tell you right now, I see words on the page, and I don't know what to say. And what was the 11th grader saying to me? I don't know how to decode. So if you're going to ask me to analyze the rest of the documents, I can't decode. You're going to ask me to determine the main idea of the text, and I can't decode. You're going to ask me to do a word problem, a real world word problem, math problem, in a mathematical situation, and can't decode. And brain research says, if you can't decode upwards of 95% of the words that you encounter when you're reading, you won't be able to subsequently do anything with that text. You are illiterate. So he read an 11th grade text to me and he fumbled through it. And the words he could not decode, he made up words. So I brought it down to the 8th grade text and he had the same fear in his eyes. He could not decode. So then I brought it down to the 4th grade level and he read with ease. Malpractice for allowing an 11th grader to not be able to read on at the developmentally appropriate expectations. But I'm proud to say, after having worked with his high school, I just got the report from Arkansas yesterday and I tweeted it, that school demonstrated the most significant gains in ELA in the state of Arkansas. And people fought me in that building and I fought their asses back. For the sake of children. Are y'all with me? I don't mean to say ass, let me take it back. Now, on the other side of what it takes to get children to literacy, some of your students, they can call out the words on the page successfully, they can decode. They can call out the tier one words, they can call out the tier two words, they can call out the tier three words, but they have no idea what they mean. And you know why they don't know what they mean? Let me say it this way. You know why children don't understand what they read on a page? Because they don't understand what they read in a paragraph. Because they don't understand what they read in a sentence. Because they never understood what they read in a series of phrases. Because they did not understand individual words. Because they did not understand the meaning of the word parts. Of the word parts that made up the word, that made up the phrase, that made up the sentences, that made up the paragraph. Made up the chapters. Are y'all with me? And there are only 30 prefixes, 30 root words, and 30 suffixes standing in the way of your children being able to create meaning while they read. Because what's happening in your mind as you're reading? You're decoding. You know what sounds to make. And what's happening on the other side of your brain? You are trying to create the meaning or understand what the parts of the words meant as you were saying them. That has to happen in your brain on a parallel pathway while you're reading. So when I say the word egregious, I've got to be thinking E means out, greed means group, and us means fully. Therefore, egregious means fully outside of the group. That's reading. And too many of our children are pronouncing the word, but they have no idea what the parts of the words mean. Therefore, they're not creating meaning while they're reading. They're calling out words. But then we have questions for them after they have called out words. And if they have not created meaning. Those questions are going to sound foolish. And by the way, don't be excited when children get the proficiency on a multiple choice test that has, what do you call it, probability on their side. You get excited when children have access to an assessment opportunity and there's an open-ended question and their help has to come from above. Y'all get that too long. So don't go on a multiple choice test that's at a little grade level. It's no service to children. And we're too excited about 30 or 40% of our populations getting to proficiency. You know, growth is good, but proficiency is the bar. And some folks say, if our kids just came from better homes, guess what? You can't control that. And underperformance is not about the zip code. Underperformance is about the instruction in the zip code. Okay. If we want kids to be able to think critically about what they've read, what's below the blue, and what's to the flame, and what's to the left and to the right, cannot be a barrier to them. We want them to think critically about what they read, but they can't decode, they can't create meaning, they don't understand tier one, tier two, or tier three words, good luck. Because you can hope all you want to, but hope is not a strap. Hope has to be attached to good service to children. And we want kids to be able to write, because reading is breathing in. All this is breathing in. This is breathing out. This is breathing out. But if you didn't breathe in, you will never successfully breathe out. Because if you get to code and create meaning, you understand tier one, tier two, and tier three words, when somebody asks you to think relative to what you have read, you don't have a struggle. When someone asks you to write relative to what you have read, you don't have a struggle. Okay, let me say it this way. When somebody cuts you off in traffic, do you need a sentence starter? You call on multiple sources, you call on your ancestors to put together words for them. And the reason why my children have nothing to push out is because they didn't go in, because they couldn't decode, they couldn't create meaning, they didn't understand the tier one and the tier two and the tier three words. Okay, do me a favor. Turn and talk to somebody next to you. I know this is dangerous, but I'm going to do it. What are you thinking? Get it out. Talk to somebody next to you. Go.